A7 GQL was a hard misc challenge. It combines a database query injection with optimizing the algorithm to perform the attack. So also partially a programming or a computer science challenge. When I first read the title, I mispronounced it as GQL, so a more German pronunciation, and I totally didn't get what it tried to hint at. But more about it later. Let's get started. A7, GQL. We installed a fancy automatic attack protection system to be more secured against automated attacks from robots and hackers so it can be fully A7 compliant. And a hint with YAML tilde. So the first thing I did was look up A7 again, because of the fully A7 compliant comment. I immediately thought it's probably that OWASP thing. So what is it again? OWASP top 10, A7, insufficient attack protection. Oh, that thing. What a bullshit item on the OWASP list. If you want to read about some infosec drama, search for A7 controversy. And this challenge is certainly a reference to that. Anyway, I took this as a hint that I should use some automated attack tool, which in retrospect I think was wrong, but whatever. The description has a few more hints, but we will get back to that in a minute. Let's first check out the site. The challenge here links a HTML file with the following content. So part of the subdomain can be random. It's obviously to give every player a unique site. We will see that come up later. On the site itself, we can find a simple login field, and when we inspect the HTML, we see a validation pattern that tells us the username has to be admin and the password has to follow a more complex pattern. It's basically a valid flag pattern. CTF, curly braces, then some characters that start with quotas, and if you paid attention, you can see that the subdomain is basically that part here, and then followed by 64 characters. So it seems like if we find the correct password for the admin user, we have found the flag. Like I said, I thought the A7 hint meant to tell me to use some tool, so I used Nikto, which basically does something like dirbuster, and it found an app.yaml file. It turns out I could have found that myself if I had looked into the robots.txt. Oh well. That QA entry here threw me a bit off, but I ignored it mostly. And this is where the second hint comes into play, the YAML tilde. Some editors, such as Emacs or maybe Vim, create files to track your current progress in case you don't save and it crashes or so. Then it can be recovered. And some editors create a file with the same name but append a tilde. And that's basically what happened here. The developer apparently opened the file in an editor and it created that tilde file, and for some reason it didn't get deleted. The YAML file is really interesting. It's basically a web application config file for Google App Engine, and it tells us here where the app that handles the page lives. I might also Google a little bit to learn more about App Engine to understand the structure of this file. So basically, I'm hunting now for the application sources. In the Google App Engine docs, I find a Hello World example using main.py, so I tried that. And with the tilde there as well, I can leak the content. So now we got the sources. The code doesn't look too big, but there are some dense areas. A first thing you might notice is that there's something about quotas and abuse detection system. And when I looked at the code, there was a lot of time calculations, and I hoped I didn't have to understand that right now. So I continued. Here the login post request. That must be very important. And indeed, I immediately noticed a query language injection. You can see this here, the colon one together with the parameter here is safe, but this direct Python string manipulation with %s is unsafe. We can inject another single quote and break out of the string and screw with the query. So is this an SQL injection? Well, kinda, not really. As you can see here in the function name, it's GQL, Google Query Language. At this point, I still didn't get that the title of the challenge was supposed to hint for that, GQL, but oh well. So what can we do with that? Ideally, we want to be able to log in. So what kind of features could we use in the query language? If you look up the grammar of the query language, it's really short and there's not much you can do. So we are here in the where condition, and all we can do is append more conditions with and. There is not even an or. And we could sort or limit the result, but that's not really useful. So no SQL union select to inject the password we can control to bypass the authentication or so. The only output we have is either wrong username or wrong password. So it's going to be a blind injection. The idea is, if we make the query return a password, then the password we supply would be wrong, and if we make the query return no password, we would get the wrong username error. We can play with this. GQL doesn't have advanced string stuff like SQL. For example, there is no where password like A percentage, where password like B percentage to slowly brute force the first character. But we can basically simulate that with greater or lower than. So you can inject a compare if the password is bigger than A, and if that's the case, the query returns the password and we get a wrong password error. But if the password was not bigger than A, then the password might start with A or another char that's lower than that, then the query would not return a password and we get the wrong username error. So we can in fact slowly brute force the password. So I start writing some code to do that. The comparison works by ASCII values, so the order of chars is how they appear in ASCII. So lowercase a is bigger than capital A. So I was writing that code, but I quickly ran into the abuse detection system. I was banned for 90 seconds because I either triggered 2 errors in 30 seconds, or made more than 13 requests per 30 seconds, or it took me longer than 2240 seconds. Oh, damn. Because with every request we get an error, we can only perform one request every 15 seconds. And not only that, we only have 2240 seconds time for that. That's only 150 requests. But the flag is already at least 64 bytes long. We know parts of the password, just not the main part. This means we have only like 2 requests per character. We will never brute force the password with those restrictions. So I started to review more of the code, and long story short, I couldn't find a bypass for the abuse detection system. Also, the password is dynamically generated, but it's safe. It's HMAC with a secret key and the first part of the hostname, which means if you know the secret key and I give you a valid flag, you can verify that it's valid. The first part generates the second part. So also no tricks possible there. Basically, I had the following options in mind. First, bypass the detection system. Second, find an issue in the dynamic flag or password generation. Third, a better GQL injection. Fourth, try to optimize the brute force. And like I said, first one led nowhere, second one was also unlikely, third one, too, the query syntax is just too short, which means the only viable way is optimization. So an obvious first improvement to the brute force with greater and lower is to do a binary search. Basically, we have an oracle that tells us with a guess of the password if the real password is greater or lower, which means we can lower the amount of requests necessary. My first implementation did this per character. Each character has 64 options, and with a binary search, you can find the right guess in about log n steps, so about 4.1 steps necessary per character, which means we need roughly 262 steps in total, which doesn't work, because we can only do up to 150 requests in the time we have. So I was stuck there for a while. A lot of time went into fixing programming bugs and testing it, because it's so slow with one request every 15 seconds, it just took ages. But when I did another round of auditing the code, I noticed something. So error requests, of which you can only have 2 every 30 seconds, are only counted on exceptions. And if you look closely in the login code, you see that only a wrong password triggers an exception. Wrong username is just a regular request, of which you can have 13 per 30 seconds. That's the key. We need to optimize the binary search to favor wrong username over wrong password. So how do we do that? Well, in a binary search, you always select the center of your search area. This means there is a 50-50 chance that your item is either greater or lower. So how can we skew that chance? Well, instead of picking the center, we pick something more towards one side. For example, if we do a 75-25 split, we have a much higher probability that our item is going to be lower than that new index. In our case, we can have 13 requests in 30 seconds, but only 2 of those can be errors. So we have 2 divided by 13, roughly a 85-15% split. Awesome. Also, I optimized the string generation by working with numbers rather than a character string. So basically, our string we want to brute force has an alphabet of 64 characters. So it's like a base64 number system, which means we can convert between base10 and base64. Don't confuse it with base64 encoding. I'm really talking here about the mathematical numeral system base64. Maybe you had to convert base10 to base16 or base3 in school. That's basically what I did. So I created two functions to convert a base64 number to a base10 number and vice versa. So now I can treat the binary search as a search of a number. The highest value is basically lowercase zzzzz, which is a huge number. And this is the code I came up with. I used the requests module to perform the GQL injection request. Then I define the alphabet for the flag in ASCII order. Here are my functions to convert from base64 to base10 and vice versa, and a function to display a number line to visualize the search. And here are the important search variables. At the beginning, the highest number is basically zzzz, and lowest is obviously 0. The current flag we will check, so the search index, is initialized with 85% from the top, so that it's skewed towards higher values and our real password is probably lower. And those are lists to count the exceptions, so wrong passwords and regular requests I make. At the beginning of the search loop, I have a look at the list that remember all exceptions and requests and remove the requests that are older than 30 seconds, because they don't matter anymore. But if we have had more than one exceptions in the past 30 seconds, or had more than 11 regular requests, we are going to sleep for a second. Then we clean up the list again and maybe sleep again, until the condition is not true anymore. Then we are allowed to perform another request. So we convert the current search index to the flag string and perform the request. Some nice log output, and then we check the result. If it was wrong username, then our guess was bigger than the real password, so we can set the highest possible value to that and move the search index down a little bit. But always move it in the 85 to 15% ratio. If we get wrong password, we get an exception. So we remember we had the exception, and we also know our password was greater than our guess. So we take the upper part and move the search index higher. And that's it. We just have to let it run now. Doesn't it look beautiful? Here you can see how the search index, the x always skews to the higher value, and how the search space is narrowed down. And there's a nice ratio now of wrong username and wrong password requests. This takes now a while. Basically 2240 seconds or 37 minutes. But we will still just barely make it in time. So I started many instances in parallel and hope that at least one will succeed. And this is where I started to become nervous, because the end of the CTF was approaching and I was not sure if it will work. I didn't have one successful run yet. Will the flag I found work or will it break? Will I do my calculations right? Do I have bugs? And about 10 minutes before the end, two processes approach the final guesses. There we go. Search space is apparently now zero. We found our flag. Hopefully. So I tried to enter the flag, super shaky hands, because I had to be fast with the minutes left, but it didn't work. Wrong flag. Also, I couldn't log in with this flag. It was not correct. Damn. But I had a hunch what the problem was. I probably didn't quite get the calculations correct, so I was probably one or two numbers off. So I just adjusted the last character of the flag, and after a few attempts, I got the right flag. Damn, that was close. But really happy at the end, because, just FYI, I spent probably like 12 hours on this challenge.